you Quarantined? Quarantined is a virtual interview series where we spread ideas during the pandemic. Today we have sub-collector of Kollam district, Shikha Surendran IAS, who was also topper of UPSC from Kerala with a dream rank of 16. Welcome, ma'am. We will begin with this obligatory question. People tend to create the very first image of an IAS officer or a collector from what they see in films. But how different is a collector in real from that of real?
Okay. An IAS officer in field duty, like collector is a field posting only. He's a person who is designated to implement the policies of government. And these officers are bound to work and act within the framework of rules and regulations. So as we see in films, nobody can bring drastic changes within a short span of time. It's a long continuous process. It's not a one-man show as well. A good team is required for bringing these changes. A bureaucrat with good leadership quality and efficient team can bring changes. And this needs time also. By that period, mostly the officers are promoted to some other post. And the new successor may not follow the steps of the predecessor. So these challenges are there, but still many officers have achieved success. And the results of their works can be seen maybe after 10 years, but changes can be made. It's not as fast as we see in films. Then an IAS officer acts from policy formulation till policy implementation. So the scope and relevance of the service thus remains intact. Films as we see Mammootty, films naturally portray officers are someone like superheroes who is capable of doing anything. An IAS officer may not be masculine, but it's important to remain healthy given the hectic work schedule. And rather than being aggressive or superhuman, it's always better for an officer to remain compassionate and empathetic to the cause of people.
Yes, ma'am. UPSC coaching can be expensive, stressful, and tiring. There will always be this opportunity cost associated with it, either the option of higher studies or of a placement. So how did you manage all this? Also, what made you leave Delhi and start your own preparations?
Okay, so there are a lot of questions in it. I think first one is whether it is expensive. So the answer is yes. As per my experiences, because I studied in Delhi. So in Delhi, it was including hostel fees and some other expenses will also come. So it's expensive. And I had taken a few personal loans and had some personal borrowings as well to go for the civil service coaching. Next question, it is about higher studies, right?
Yes, ma'am.
So I had no plan for going for higher studies, to be honest, because it was my childhood dream to become a collector or an IAS officer. But after my BTech, when I finished BTech, I wanted to support my family after earning a job, because my family was not that much financially better off. So that confusion was there. So my confusion was for whether to opt for a normal job or to go for civil service coaching. So I opted for the second. Then why Delhi? That question, there was no proper guidance for me at that time. There was no mentor also to ask doubts to whether where to start, where to go for coaching. So normally, I think we hear that Delhi is the best place to do coaching.
Yes.
So hence I opted for Delhi. That is the answer.
Also, what was your father's part in this dream?
Okay. So initially I told that it was my childhood dream. So I started dreaming about civil services when I was studying in sixth standard. So when I was studying in sixth standard, it was actually my father's dream to see his daughter as an IAS officer. So he told me that according to my aptitude and talent, I'm eligible to become an IAS officer. So it gradually became my dream, and he guided me throughout the journey. He took me to almost all the competitions that happened at the school levels and which were conducted by other organizations as well. He taught me speeches and essays from high school level itself. So totally, he was an inspiration for me. When I fall, he was an inspiration to rise whenever I fall. Then during my high school days, my father fell sick. Then my family was not financially sound that time. Then after my graduation, as I earlier stated, I was confused whether to get placed somewhere so that I could support my family or to go ahead with civil service coaching. At that time also, my father had no doubt. Irrespective of our financial condition, he sent me to Delhi for coaching. When I failed in my first attempt also, he gave me confidence. So I have observed that his illness never affected his mental willpower. Likewise, in Kurukshetra war, Bhagavan Shri Krishna was the charioteer of Arjuna who guided him to success. So in my journey towards this success, my father was my charioteer.
That's very adorable. Okay, ma'am. Often aspirants who join UPSC are just freshers without any particular work experience. But as soon as they complete coaching, they are appointed as not coach. They are appointed as a high rank official. So, how does the Lal Bahadur Shastri Academy of National Administration, aka Labasna, transform or mold a civil servant out of an ordinary person?
Okay, Labasna was like a dream place for me when I was preparing. I think for almost all aspirants, when we feel demotivated during our preparations. For me, I used to see the videos of Labasna and it will give me such level of inspiration that I will study for the entire day. In Labasna, actually, we will be having foundational course, induction training, then post-mid-career professional training. It consists of theory and practical classes. So the main focus is to shape our attitudes and giving some common set of values and upgrading our professional skills. So these are achieved by academic classes also. In addition to that, we have leadership training programs, group discussions, movie screening, then panel discussions, role plays, etc., etc. When we talk about practical classes or setting aside this academic classes, we have other segments also, like we have winter study tour, also called as Bharat Darshan. That kind of videos are also available in YouTube, which is giving motivation to most of the people. So Bharat Darshan is an opportunity to understand the diverse culture of the nation. So in my winter study tour, I traveled through 10 to 12 states, including union territories. So it's a major chance to study the location-specific needs or understanding the innovative ideas that has happened in different places of our country, whether it is replicable in our state, like we can study the mindset of the people, then good work done by officers, etc., etc. Similar to this, we have village study tour as well. So it's like a 15 days of camping in a remote village. For me, it was Devapur Kotmi in Madhya Pradesh. So it was entirely different from the villages of Kerala. So in that kind also, we used to get a more exposure to the ground level reality and understand the people of that place. Then other thing is trekking exercise that is happening in the academy. So it also trains us to cope up with the adverse condition, the bad weather, and to adjust with the minimal infrastructure. Then coming to the celebrations in the academy, it's also completely different. We have India Day celebrations in which we are able to understand various culture of the nation, the traditions, etc. On the similar line, we have Sonal Day celebration also. It helps the officer trainees to acquaint with the culture and cuisine of the allotted cadres. So when I specifically talk about Indian Administrative Service, after around 10 months of campus training, we are sent into the field for 1 year district training. So in Kerala, it is called as Assistant Collector under training. For me, it was in Kottayam district. So during this period, we are attached with different departments. departments. Almost all important departments, we have attachments, including independent charge. So I have taken the independent charge of Taluk Tahsildar and sub-collector for around 2 months while in Kottayam. Mm-hmm. So through all these things, we are getting a field level experience also. So after this field level experience, we are again called back to the academy for the phase two training. So unfortunately, this time due to COVID, we had it online only. So in this training period, we almost interact with all the officers and we will share our experiences and we will seek the solutions. So in this way, including campus training and field training, we are given the exposure to the government system. And then we are joining the service as independent officers.
Now I can imagine why you watch Labasna videos for motivation. Everyone joins service with an aim to satisfy personal ambition as well as to indulge in public welfare. But how limited is an officer in the pursuit of the same?
Okay. So I think the answer will overlap with the answer of how different an officer is seen as in films, as in reality. So this service, first of all, we have to understand that the service is actually an opportunity to do many things rather than concentrating on our personal ambitions. So a priority will be for utilizing this opportunity, because only very few people got this opportunity to make changes in the society. So we will utilize it. The file signed by the officers, the policy suggestions given, or the implementation of schemes, etc., are part of social welfare. So in that sense, we can say that almost all the officers are doing social welfare regularly. It's part of their work only. So in every postings, an officer should try to do their best to serve that department. Likewise, if I am having interest in doing something on women empowerment or child development, but I am posted as director of something else, so I just can't go behind my personal ambition, but I should strive to do the best in the posting that I am getting. So that is why I said that more than personal ambition, just focus it as an opportunity and do our best. And limitations, it's similar, like we have to work within the rules and regulations and we can't go beyond that.
Misogyny and hate speeches are increasing day by day on our social media platforms. Do you think that change should be made in our curriculum in order to change the way our society treats women?
Sure, but I don't think that change in curriculum alone will work. About curriculum, a major part has to be done by our parents, because gender stereotyping starts right from childhood. It is what my experience say to me, because I have heard my grandparents saying that the girl child should be fair and beautiful, she shouldn't shout or she shouldn't whistle. Like that, we hear a lot of things, because mostly it may be due to their ignorance as well, but still these kinds of dialogues unknowingly is creating a negative attitude towards women. So a major change has to be brought in the process of the upbringing of children at home. Kids learn from their family only. If his father is not giving respect to his mother, he will also not do. He will feel that wives are to be treated like that only. If his father is saying that his mother has no work at home, he will also consider that being a housewife means jobless and free. So this attitude have to be changed. People have already started discussions, debates on these topics. That itself is a good sign. And social media obviously has played a vital role in it. So I think that our girls, especially our girl children, should be taught to dream success in life beyond fairness, beauty and marriage. She should be taught that she should have a dignified, independent life. The stories of maybe Bachendri Pal, Sunita Williams, Kalpana Chawla, Mary Kom, etc. should be taught to our kids right from the school. Above all this, let us give the chance to speak. Let her voice be heard. Don't blame or victimize or for a crime happened. It's very familiar that mostly after a sexual assault or something, the main thing that is happening is victimization. Every time we call her victim only, we rarely call her a survivor. So that kind of attitude should also change. So we should actually try to tear off the fear and anxiety from their minds. I just want to mention one incident in this question. After my selection in UPSC, I had a session with the students, children in the Nirbhaya Care Center at Trivandrum. So during that interaction, a girl of about 10-year-old maybe, she stood up in from the audience and asked me a question that whether the dress she had worn that day was the reason for her sexual assault. So I was thinking that a 10-year-old girl in the Kerala society feels that due to her dress, she was raped at the age of 10. So that kind of attitude should definitely be changed from our society. So that kind of awareness should be spread among our parents, teachers, and society. So when I talk about our academy, we had sessions by the acid attack survivor Lakshmi, then transgender people, then the founder of Prajula, Sunita Krishnan ma'am, etc. So we should also give these sessions to our school students and colleges. Their sufferings and stories should be taught to prevent such crime and mishaps. So in last year also, Kerala too had incidents of attacking girls for proposal denial and hatred. So we have to start sensitizing our students, especially teenagers and college students. Children should be taught the value of democracy. Everyone has the right to deny and say no. It will not be pleasant. If someone is proposing us and we can't deny it, otherwise we will be killed. It's not democracy. So we should teach our students and youth to accept that denial, and they should accept it as a reality. So we have to spread awareness first among our parents, then teachers, and the entire society should be made aware of this reality. Multidimensional approach through education and awareness will only work in this. So as a part of that, curriculum should also be changed.
That was a strong message. I guess this is an important question. Ma'am, have you ever felt the need for proving yourself in this post just because being a woman?
As of now, I have not felt it. Maybe I just entered the service 2 years back only. Maybe I have not experienced it. Doesn't mean that it is applicable to all others. Maybe I can answer this question after 10 or 20 years of service.
Yes, ma'am, your score for Malayalam literature might be decisive in the UPSC rank. Were you fond of literature from earlier days, or just you took Malayalam as optional?
No. Actually, I love Malayalam language so much. Because my father had a good hold in Malayalam language. He used to write stories, and he encouraged me to do so from childhood days. And I was more focused on essay writing, actually, because I have participated in many essay writing competitions, and I have won at state level also during my plus two period. So then I have studied classical music for around 8 years. So I have participated in reciting poems as well. So all these things had brought a love for Malayalam language. Actually, after my plus two, I wanted to do a graduation in Malayalam literature only. But at that time, various factors were there. Like, first of all, I had a full A plus in my plus two. So at that time, I think society was thinking that if we are having full A plus, either we should go for engineering or we should go for medicine. I was a computer science student, and I definitely had no interest in medicine. So my left out option was engineering. Then the second question was whether engineering or Malayalam literature. Then I thought that since my family was not financially sound, and if unfortunately if I couldn't make it into civil services, anyway I have to support my family. So I thought that it is better to have a profession in my hand. That's why I opted for engineering. So I actually missed the chance to study Malayala literature at that time. So when it came to civil services, I actually found that chance, an opportunity to study Malayala literature. So I took it. I scored very good marks, actually. You said it right. And it was very decisive in getting me the rank of 16 also. The reason may be I love the language. And while I was studying Malayala literature for UPSC exams, I was not feeling that I was studying. I was feeling that I was doing something passionate. So that made the difference in the marks, I feel.
Yes, ma'am. I don't know if it's too much to ask, but still, ma'am, can you recite a poem or sing a song for us?
Professor V. Madhusudana Nayarude Ganga ennulla kavithayanu. Enikku ethavum priyappetta oru kavitha ayathukondu enikku thonnu mostly ella programs ilum njan repeated aayittu paadarullu onnu thanneyanu ennu. Ninne kurichaaru paadum devi ninne thiranjaaru kelum സ്മൃതിയിലും പുണ്യം തളിക്കുന്ന ഗംഗേ വരണാവു താഴുമീ വംശതീരങ്ങളിൽ നിന്നെഞ്ചിലുറവാറു തേടും അരികെ വെൻ തിങ്കളിൽ തേനുണ്ടോരുണ്ട് തിരിവച്ച് വാഴ്ചയ്ക്കൊരുങ്ങുവോരുണ്ട് നിമിഷനിധി എണ്ണി പഴന്തുണി കിഴികെട്ടി നിലവറ നിറയ്ക്കുന്ന വൈശ്രവണനുണ്ട് ഭക്തന്റെ വീർപ്പും വിയർപ്പും ഒളിപ്പിച്ച് ഭുക്തിക്കൊരുങ്ങുന്ന കൂതഗണമുണ്ട് ചെറ്റും മറയ്ക്കാത്ത നാളത്തിനാൽ ബ്രഹ്മവിദ്യയ്ക്ക് ഭാഷ്യം ചമയ്ക്കുകൂറുണ്ട് ദുഷ്ടതന്ത്രങ്ങളിൽ സിദ്ധിയേറ്റി കവിത സൃഷ്ടികൾ നേടി ചമഞ്ഞിരിപ്പോരുണ്ട് ഇവിടെ ഈ ചുടലയണി പൂതിയാക്കി ഇവിടെ ഈ ചുടലയണി പൂതിയാക്കി തിലകമിരുനേരവും ചാർത്തി നാമം ജപിക്കുന്ന നാഭിയ നാദം വിശന്നു വിളിക്കൂട്ടുന്ന ഞങ്ങളുണ്ട് ഭാരതീയരും എങ്കിലും നിന്നെ കുറിച്ചാറു പാടും
പോരെ. Life of a civil servant is very stressful and tiring. We have this beautiful, like brilliantly depicted novel Yantram by Malayattu Ramakrishnan, which says the same. So how do you restore your energy levels? What are your hobbies? Also, how do you find time to spend with your family?
Okay, let me start from the last question, how we are finding time to spend with our family. I think we have to purposefully find the time for family. Otherwise, we will not be able to get time for family. Every time the official phone will be ringing, something or the other will be happening. And if we continue to stay in the office, we can continue there till midnight also. So I am purposefully finding time for my family. Somehow I am trying to finish my works at least by 6 or 7 so that I can spend time with my family. So it will be same for almost all offices. So that is the answer. Then the second thing is how will I restore my energy levels? Two answers. First answer is that, like I was saying, for my option of Malayalam literature, similarly, I wish to become an IAS officer. So when I am doing my duty, generally I will not be getting bored. Maybe I am just 2 years in the service. I will not be feeling that much hectic as of now. Maybe my answer will be different after 10 or 20 years. I don't know. But as of now, I'm feeling that I'm doing something which I wish to do or which I dreamt to do for many years. So in that case, doing that or getting some success means if some people is coming with a complaint to me, it will be very small complaint. It will not be any large complaint that we will see in movies. will be very small complaint, but if I am able to find a solution for that, I will see the smile on their faces. So in that way, I can restore my energy levels. Then other thing is regarding my hobby, definitely, as I said that I have learned classical music for 8 years. Even though I'm not singing classical Carnatic music, but I used to sing feeling songs when I am just moving around here and there. I used to listen to music also. Then at some point of time, I will feel that I should write something. Then I will write. So I will write something. So all these things try get me my energy levels back. Also, I used to take my scooty. I have a scooter over here. So I just take my scooter and I will just ride around the town. That will also, that kind of short trips also help me in restoring my energy levels.
Okay, ma'am. Which is the one book that changed your perspective?
Okay. Then I have no particular answer for this. Every book I read, they will be having one or more points which will invoke some thought process in me. So in that way, sometimes a Facebook post or a newspaper column will also do the same purpose. So every book or a good writer which invokes thinking is a book which is influencing me. When it comes to my journey to civil services, I think Wings of Fire, Agni Chiragugal by Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam was a book which influenced me or motivated me.
Yes, ma'am. We will conclude by this. What's your message to all aspirants out there?
Okay. So I have answered this question many times after getting into civil services. So I try to improvise on my answer also. Generally, the question is like that, what is the message and what is the tip for civil service aspirants? So as such, I have no particular tip to give. But as per my experiences, I will just want to say a few things. Like, this will not be an easy journey, for sure. And the second thing is, people used to say that you should study 8 to 10 hours a day. You should study these much books. This is compulsory for clearing the exam and all. These all are myths, according to me, because even after my selection, I have said it in many interviews, and even some, I have seen the comments like, this girl is lying, we can't clear exam like this. So because maybe marketing strategies, it may be, I don't know, but still, to be very honest, I had done smart work in the sense that you should understand the syllabus first and study within the syllabus. That is very important. Don't go beyond that. It's not about the quantity or the time period that you are studying. It's just about the quality and the focus of study. So just concentrate on these two points. Then the next thing is answer writing practice. Like we have to write exam for around 6 hours. Means it is 3 hour exam, forenoon and afternoon. 6 hour exam continuously for 4 to 5 days. I think last year this exam timetable was a little more relaxed. For my exam in 2018, it was like Monday to Friday we had to write exam. 6 hours per day we are writing, our hands will be paining like anything and we'll be totally exhausted. Mostly in the forenoon exam we'll be feeling like we are done, we are not able to write anything more. So we should be very hard. So more than being hard, if we are giving much focus on answer writing practice, because we are already molded for writing that exam, it will be giving a good hold while on exam hold. That is the thing. Then do your best. That is what I want to say. Even if you are failing after that, you will not be having any regrets. So do your part, do well, and even if you are failing or you are not able to make it to the final list, the knowledge that you have on during this civil service preparation will be a lifelong asset for you. and definitely life will be waiting with some more surprises for you. So don't worry about the outcome, but just focus on your hard work. All the best wishes. That's it.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much for finding time amidst your busy schedule. I truly believe that this session will be inspirational for many. Thank you.
You're welcome.